Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I'd like to welcome you again to one of our local history shows. I'm George Thorman, and this is our last show of the season until September. I have with me two guests tonight. The first one is William Harold Jewell, who is known as Harry, and he is 84 years of age at the present time, and he's going to talk about the early days when he was a child and when he was working with the traction line. And I'd like to welcome you. I think it's very nice of you, Mr. Jewell, to come on the program. Mr. Jewell is also an excellent gardener and a very, very fancy woodworker. We're not going to talk about those, but a lot of people will probably know him for the fine woodworking that he does. My other guest is Paul Loucks, who's in the history department at Central Elgin Collegiate, and who has done a considerable amount of research on the traction line and the LNPS, and is quite an expert in the early history of the early railroads of Elgin County. Paul, I know how busy you are this week. I'd like to thank you for coming on the program very much. Now, what we're going to start is, I'm just going to take Mr. Jewell back to the time he was born, and I'll start out there. Mr. Jewell, when were you born?
March the 14th, 93.
1893. And where'd you go to school?
I went to the old Myrtle Street School until the spring of 1903.
How big was that school?
Well, I think it was only two stories high. That'd be eight rooms, four rooms on each.
It had eight rooms,
eh? Uri was the principal. And Miss Saunders was one of my teachers, Miss Lamond. And then I went to Union.
Well, when did your family move to Union?
We moved to Union on the 1st of April, 1903. On a farm a mile west of Union. And I went to school down there to about three different teachers. Then I went to work for Mr. Whaley.
Well, now, I just want to stop you there because you did go to school at Union.
Yeah.
And you were telling me you should have gone to Bain School instead of Union.
Way over on the top of the Fingal Hill and south a little bit, 3 miles from home. We lived in Southold. Of course, we were going to Union School. That's Yarmouth. So there were three of us, my older sister and my younger brother and myself. We had to pay 75 cents a month to the teacher.
Because you were a non-resident in Yarmouth Township.
Right. Well, it went all right for a few years, and then a new teacher came by the name of Weir. Dave Weir, but he wouldn't have nothing to do with the 75 cents, so we didn't pay anything.
You didn't pay anything.
And when the Dufties moved, they were related to mine, they moved on the farm. They bought a little house in Union. That's how they got around it.
I see.
Their children didn't have to pay because they owned property in the Army.
Yeah. I'm sure the people would be interested in buying education at 75 cents a pupil today. I don't know what our non-resident fees are now. They're something like $40, $50 a month, I think. Yeah. Well, now, in Union, you went to school until about 1907.
Yes, I was going to school either the day before my birthday or the day after. It's a long while ago. I forget which.
Yeah.
And Mr. Whaley, that run the farm, that's the golf links today, come out and wanted to know if I'd come and work for him, that his boy, Lorne, was sick for 2 or 3 weeks. Well, I went, but I stayed till the end of the year and never went back to school.
So what grade were you in when you left school?
I do tell you. It was, well, I got nowhere near the entrance.
No.
I just forget what it was.
Well, when your father, who worked in St. Thomas, bought the farm and went out there and became a farmer, you stayed home and helped him a great deal, too, did you?
Well, I did until I was seven, until 1907.
Yeah.
Then when I went to Whaley's, I stayed there that year. The next year, I used to sleep home, but I worked out the day.
Can you tell me what you made the salary when you worked with the Whaley farm?
$7 a month, first place.
And your board?
My board, I lived right there with them.
Yeah.
And then
would you save any money on $7 a month?
Not very much. No, I wasn't thinking about saving money then, Dave.
Yeah. Well,
but I was like all the rest of them. We didn't have much money.
No. Well, you didn't smoke or
I did a little. I've quit about four times, I think. It only lasts for a while.
Yeah, I don't know who it was. Mark Twain, somebody said it's easy to stop smoking. I've done it 100 times.
Well, yeah. I haven't smoked for a long while now.
No.
I never was a very heavy smoker. No.
So you worked for $7 a month till the end of 1902.
1907.
Yep. All right. That's, I'm sorry. And then in 1908, you went and worked.
Well, I lived home, but I worked all of the day, nearly every day. If I didn't, I stayed home and worked. I didn't pay any board, nor I just lived.
Well, now, what would you be paid for that kind of work,
Well, mostly $1 a day and my dinner.
$1 a day and your dinner.
Yeah. Uh-huh. That's about as much as I ever got working by the day.
Uh-huh. They're now talking about, what is it, $4 an hour for minimum wage in the province of Ontario. But $1 a day.
And the dinner.
And how long was that day? What time would you report
for it?
Well,
them days you were in the field at 7 o'clock. Yeah. You stayed there till noon and you were back shortly after 1 till 6. Mm. And then you had to do your milk and chores after that.
Yeah. And then you'd go home.
Yeah, and go home and sleep and come back early in the morning.
Next day, yeah. And that's for $1 a day in your noon hour meal, eh?
Yeah.
Well, then, who did you work? You went with a Mr. Marlatt.
Well, that was 1908 that I was home. In 1909, Art Marlatt bought the farm next to us, and he was a cripple, 100 acres. Well, the railroad goes through it. It was 100 acres
The
railroad.
Yeah. Oh, I see.
And I worked for him. I did all that was done because he was a cripple.
Yeah.
He was going around with a cane like I did.
I see. And what did he pay you?
Well, I'm sure it was $12 a month on my board, but I lived right there.
I see.
Got all my meals and my washing and my board.
And $12 a month.
He had two sisters keep house
for him. And then in 1910, there was a big split in your family.
Yes.
You tell us what happened?
Father and mother and 11 kids all went west. Well, the oldest one was married.
Yeah.
11 kids all went west but me, and I was the only one that didn't go.
Why didn't you go?
Oh, I don't know. I suppose maybe there's a girl mixed up in it or something like that.
Was there really?
I might have had a girlfriend. I don't know why I didn't.
That's
go.
Not the girl you married, though.
No. She was more like a sister.
I
anyhow, I didn't go. I was out. Oh, I've been out many a time since the season, but. I went to work for Mitch Hebern, old Mitch.
Yeah.
He was about 70 or 72. I worked there for 8 months.
Now, tell me something. You always, when we're talking, say Hebern.
Well, it was always Hebern.
That's the way they said it.
It never was Hepburn until young Mitch got into the Parliament.
I see.
Then it was Hepburn. It's been Hepburn. And I get used to saying Hebern. It was always Hebern.
Well, that's interesting.
There's lots of Heberns down there, and they were all Hebern.
And they're all Hepburns now,
though. Yeah, now they're Hepburn.
Yeah. Now, did you go to school with you worked for Mitch Hepburn, who was the grandfather the Mitchell Hepburn, we know as premier. And you worked on the farm which is now an open-air
theater. Two hired men.
Yeah, and that's the farm which is now the
open-air theater on the farm.
Well, did you go to school with young Mitch and his sister?
Before this, Irene and Mitch. They were smarter than I was, but they were younger.
Yeah.
Mitch was younger. Uh-huh. Irene and I were about the same age.
Now, you had Dave Weir, who was the teacher at Union, was quite a forward-looking man. Paul, you'll be interested in this, being a history teacher. Can you tell us what Mr. Weir did to encourage study of history? You remember where he had...
he was going to show us how the Parliament was run.
Uh-huh.
So they picked Harry Donnelly. He's a cheesemaker. His cheesemaker's son at the time, cheesemaker himself later, lives in Stratfordville now. Harry was we called him Tory, and Mitch, of course, was liberal.
What you called a grit.
Grit, them days. Well, during recess, Dave would have one of them speak each recess. Well, Harry would get up, and he'd have to read every word he said. But Mitch would get up there, and they'd have to stop him. They had no papers or nothing.
Yeah.
He just kept talking, and he was real.
Yes. He had a remarkable facility, and even as a child, to
marshal his
thoughts and speak so effectively.
He was smart, and he was nominated on his 21st birthday youngest one they ever nominated, I guess. I guess that's what you call it, nominated?
Yes.
21st birthday.
Yeah.
He lived with his grandfather for most of the time when I was working for him. They'd been living in Winnipeg, and then his mother and sister and him
Well, yes, his father went out to Winnipeg because there had been some trouble that trial that Mitch's father was framed, I think. But
Well, of course, we all knew that.
Yeah, you all knew that.
Well, I think everybody knew it.
Yeah. But at the same time, it was a kind of a miserable scandal.
And it was too close to election. They got another man by the name of Haight down near Sparta, but he had no time to, only a couple of weeks or something like that.
Now, how long did you work for Mitchell Hepburn?
Well, I worked first time 8 months, and then at the end of 8 months, I hired on for a year. So I worked a year and 8 months, like two seasons.
Was he a nice man to work for?
Oh, Mitch?
Yes.
Yes, a real good man to work for. He wanted his day to work, but what I mean, he was a good, he knew what he wanted, and he knew he was a good fellow to work. He had a heart as big as a balloon.
He did.
Old Mitch did.
Did he?
Yeah. I can name people that that had kids that wasn't too well off, but I even delivered presents for old Mitch around Christmas, two or three places. He had a big heart. And he'd drive along the road, and he'd tell you about this fellow, he'd give him so many loads of hay, or so many bushels of grain or something, never expected to get paid for it.
Well, Mitch had an accident with his wife, you were telling me about, that's the old Mitch.
The old Mitch. Yeah. Well, this is before my time. His wife was burnt so bad she died. Now, I don't know how long between the burn and the death, but she was burnt, so she died. Yeah. And they had two children, I'm sure, maybe three, but two anyhow, and they both died of diphtheria, I think it was diphtheria.
That was quite a child killer
of course,
in those days.
That's before my time. Then he got a lady by the name of Annie Hamilton. She had a little girl, same age as I am. She kept house for him all the time I knew him, till he died. And then,
Did he adopt other children?
No, Mitch just adopted the one, Bill.
Was the father of Mitchell Hepburn, who was the premier.
The junior, Mitch Junior, yeah.
Well, okay, so you you worked with Mitch then for 20 months, and then you left him. Who'd you work for then?
Well, I went to Van Velzer, a man by the name of Van Velzer at White Station for a year. And then I went from there to Mr. and Mrs. Lloyd on the Sparta Road. That's where the Japs live today.
I see. Yeah, nice big house in
the Sparta. One of the biggest houses in the Army.
I think it's a Kishimoto.
13 and a half foot ceilings.
That's what happened.
Yeah, well, anyhow, I worked there 2 years. Then I quit there and went on a cement contract job.
Before we go on to that, can I go back? Your career up to roughly 1913-14 is centered around Union.
Yes.
And at Union, you had a remarkable Sunday school teacher.
Well, we sure did. There's your picture.
Yeah, and this, I think people would like to see it. This was called the Optimist Club.
That's her husband right there, Mr.
That's
Lee Lloyd
and
Katie Lloyd. Her name is Katie.
It was Mrs. Lloyd.
Mr. and Mrs. Lloyd.
And
L-L-O-Y-D.
This was a Sunday school class at Union in, 1910, 11, 12?
10, 11, 12, up to, I left it in about 15. And the center row is the officers.
I see.
So you see, I'm shining there in one.
You were an officer. Yeah. Now, can you tell me about this woman was very much against drinking?
Well, in them days, they always sent temperance cards around every spring. It was the Sunday schools, and each class would get so many to sign, and sometimes ours was all boys by this time. It used to be mixed, but but this time it was boys only. And a lot of boys wouldn't sign it, a lot of them did. I can remember signing it two or three times because I never had anything to do with liquor. My mother was against all that. Anyhow, when we got through signing them, she gathered them up and she gave us a little talk on temperance. And she said if she only got at least one boy out of the class to sign it and keep it, She thought she'd done something. Well, it kind of stuck in my crop. But I guess I forgot it because it didn't bother me any. And when I grew up, I had all kinds of temptations with a bunch of young people and a hotel right in town and one another. But I never tried it, so I never liked it.
Never taken a drink in your life.
I was always afraid if I liked it, I'd take some more.
Yes.
And as long as I didn't taste it, I'd never know the difference. Well, I've never tasted liquor of any kind. No better than anybody else, but that's one thing I didn't do.
That's a remarkable record because I can remember as a small kid signing one of those cards to the church, too, and I'm afraid I broke my word.
Well,
you know? I haven't stuck at it.
That's one thing I never did if I don't do anything else.
Yeah. No, well, I think that's a remarkable achievement. And was drinking a problem then more than it is now?
Not like it. The young people, I don't think the young people, half of the bad they are now. I never heard of anybody until they were 18 or 20.
Yeah.
Well, now, you know, a lot younger than that, some of them.
I know. It's a real problem with young people.
Can't altogether blame the kids either, I don't think.
No. Listen, while we're on Union, I've got a couple of other pictures. This is a picture of the old Union School.
Well, that's after my time.
Yes, but this is where the sports club now is.
Yeah,
that's the building.
That's it.
Uh-huh.
And that tree. No, don't show up. There's a tree out in front of the school today that we all helped plant on Arbor Day, 1906. Everybody put in a shovel.
Yeah.
Dave Weir was the teacher.
And one other thing of Union that I've heard about and never seen a picture of is the
Union evaporator. And the school is right next to it, behind it.
I see. Uh-huh.
And this is George Doolittle, the man that owned it. Uh-huh. I could name them all. Well, there's one or two, maybe I forgot that. I knew them all at the time.
These are all the people who worked there.
They're all Union people, well, around Union.
I'm afraid a lot of our viewers won't understand what an evaporator factory was.
Well, one year, Mr. Doolittle would go around and offer a farmer so much for his orchard, for the one season.
Yeah.
Then we'd draw them in, and there was about 15 men in a row peeling them on peelers. And then there was twice as many girls that trimmed them. Took two girls to keep up to one boy peeling. And then they were put through the process, bleached for 40 minutes, and finally dried on the kilns on the other side of this building. They were about 10 inches thick, and they used to turn them every 2 hours by hand. And when they were dry, they crated them up and shipped them overseas for the First World War.
Well, they shipped them out west, too, because, you know, we didn't have much fruit out west.
Yeah.
That's where I come from, and I can remember eating all kinds of dried apples. As a matter of fact, I liked them just dry. But have you ever eaten dried apples?
No,
never eaten dried apples. Oh, you missed something.
One year, we used to start as early as possible, and we usually quit about sometime in December.
Is that so?
Well, one year, we had done 60,000 bushels. And he had a pile that's supposed to have had 60,000 bushel in the pile. And it took 5 acres of corn stalks to cover it, to keep him from freezing. That was the longest season he ever had.
And how long did that dried apple evaporator factory work there? You know?
Well, it was there long before I went there. And, I couldn't say. I was there in 1906 and 1914, but it was still going in 14.
Yeah.
I suppose maybe 18 or 20.
Yeah.
After
the
war,
First World War.
After the war. Yeah. That's where most of the apples went.
But you still can buy dried apples in
the
store. I don't think many people use them. But
well, those days, everybody dried their own apples.
That's right.
My mother always had a bushel of them up over the stove there, drying in the fall.
Yeah. Just cut them in slices?
Peel them and cut them in quarters.
Quarters?
That's what she used to do. That's what they did for a long while, and then they changed it over to slicing them.
And that's why I remember them as round circles.
Yeah, with a hole in them. That's where the core come out. The machine that peeled them took the core out.
I see. Okay. Well, now, maybe that's very interesting about that. Now, in the summer of 1915, you went to work for Joe Vincent.
Yeah, on the cement.
And what were you doing with him?
Well, I fed the cement mixer most of the time. You put up a lot of cribbing on a bridge or whatever, barn wall or whatever. You'd take 4 or 5 hours to put the cribbing up, but it'd only take about maybe an hour and a half or 2 hours to fill it.
Yeah.
But that's pretty hard work when you use a scoop shovel.
Yes, I know it is.
10 hours a day.
Yeah. And what would you be paid for that?
I got $35 a month on my board.
$35 a month.
For mixing cement.
For mixing
10
cement.
10 hours a day.
Yeah. And that's all done with the scoop shovel, the scoop shovels of
all
sand,
done by
the scoop
hand.
Shovels of the cement.
And the inspector, if you had a big job, there'd be an inspector. All the inspector did was dump so much cement in each hopper, but I had to get the gravel part of it in there. So many shovels of gravel to a bag of cement.
Yeah.
And of course, that's pretty hard work with a scoop shovel.
Yeah, it is, and I remember shoveling grain with a scoop shovel. Well, when you get a scoop shovel full of something, that's a pretty heavy load, isn't it?
That it is.
Now, I'm going to stop here because in 20th September 1915, you started to work with the traction line. And I think what I'm going to do is ask Paul just give us a sort of brief history of that traction line, which a lot of our people, don't know anything about. Paul?
Well, the traction line was a line that ran from ostensibly London to Port Stanley. And it was built, began in 1902, and it ran, first of all, from London to Lambeth. Then it was gradually extended to take in Talbotville. And then in 1907, it went to Port Stanley. And it was centered in London originally, and it was called the Southwestern Traction Line. And in 1907, there was a fire in London, and the a lot of the equipment of the traction line was burned, and the company never recovered from the fire and went in receivership. And it was sold in 1909 to a Toronto group headed by George Woods, and was changed to London Lake Erie Railway and Transportation Company with the idea that it would take in some of the lake business and expand its business. One of the problems the traction line had was that when it was originally built, the speculation was that it would be able to pay on the basis of passenger line, and the Pier Marquette at that time leased the LPS line and did not run a very efficient operation, so the traction thought that it could take over the passenger business, and this didn't work out too well. And then after it became London Lake Erie Railway, it ran fairly successfully up to the First World War when the LPS became electrified. The contract with the Pier Marquette ran out. The LPS, under the guidance of Stratum Beck, became very, very aggressive, and the LMPS, because it had a better route, it could handle freight traffic. By 1918, the London Lake Erie Railway was pretty well gone, and by the winter of 1918, it was finished.
November the 19th.
Yes.
With the last car run.
Yeah. Well, now back to you. You started on the 20th September 1915. And you started as a brakeman. Now, can you give us a brief resume of...
Well, I was about 3 months braking. Then I got to learn to be a conductor just in time for Christmas. And then after Christmas, I went with Bob McGregor, a motorman, and learned to be a motorman. And I lived on New Street real handy. There was no telephone, so every time they wanted somebody in a hurry, they always come over and got me, no matter what time of day or night.
Yeah.
And... then after I was there, I was married a year from the day I started down there. I got married right to the day, 16. And I got to be a dispatcher. Well, my regular hours was from 3 till midnight, or the last car I was in, whenever that was. Sometimes be 3 or 4 in the morning if the fish car was out. And that's the way it was to the end. I used to work my shift as a dispatcher, but I also took all the fish cars or snow plows or work trains I could get, besides make a little extra money. You only got 28 cents an hour, and you didn't live too high on that.
No.
I got 32 for dispatching.
I see.
And Louis Clinton, that's the father of the Clinton, Don Clinton, his father was the other dispatcher.
I see.
This was one of the criticisms of the traction, wasn't it? It was very poorly paid line as opposed to the
it couldn't be much worse, it wouldn't have.
No.
28 is the most I ever got. 32 is the most I ever got.
Do you remember when the traction was being built through Union?
Well, I drove the stakes for the surveyors about 1905 from Mrs. Hepburn's to Port Stanley. And the first car went into Port Stanley in 1907, but now I couldn't tell you how long it was being built from the fourth concession to port. But it used to come as far as Union for a little while. I know there was a car pull in every day at noon, and we'd all have to run down and see the car, and then to turn around and go back to St. Thomas. Of course, that was only just a short, maybe a couple of months, and then it went right on through to Port Stanley.
Yeah. Do you remember any of the Irish Day picnics?
Irish Day?
Yes.
Irish Day, every man on the road got 24 hours pay.
They did.
The day men, the day crews come when they were regular, and the night crews come around, started coming around about 9 or 10 o'clock. Well, when the day crews were through there around 3, they did the bumming and the night crews took over. And about 7 or 8 o'clock in the night, we'd all be in Port Stanley, although it wasn't on a regular run, and we'd come out as they called the crew. The crew would bring a car out. But on the Irishman's picnic day, the biggest day of the year, everybody got 24 hours pay. The only day of the year they did.
Could you describe what it was like for everybody, Irish Day?
Well, when you was going into Port Stanley with an empty car and you didn't keep your windows and doors shut, you'd have a load before you got anywhere near the depot. They'd shove one another in the window, in the doors, anywhere to get in. I've had a car load before I even got down to the depot, stop.
You mean, when the car is going?
The car was coming down. Of course, it couldn't go very fast, but so many hundreds of people around. We'd go down the middle of the main street in Port Stanley, and they'd be pushing one another in the windows, and then we'd pull away and leave a carload, maybe.
I've heard stories of an Irish Day picnic at Union, going down the cut there to go across the culvert, that an Irish Day picnic, the cars would really rock back and forth.
Oh,
the Irish
they did
get
a lot
in there.
Of rocking. They did a rocking most of the way. A pretty rough ride on the old traction sometimes, especially in the spring of the year. But you get used to the sway. My biggest trouble when I first went conducting was to know where I was in the dark. You'd have somebody want to get off, and they'd just give you their stop number. Well, if it's pitch dark and you're in a car, you've got to look out once in a while to find out where you are. But after you're there a while, you know by the sway where you are.
Mr. Jewell and I were talking earlier, and Union was station number 88.
88.
I was very impressed with the number of stops, and this can give you some idea of sort of one-horse outfit that the traction was. How many stops were there altogether? Can you remember?
Well, it'd be 1, 2, 3, 4. Oh, 9 or 10 between there and Port Stanley.
That'd be 98.
Stop at some farmer's gate or second concession or Edgar Johnson's back at Edgar Johnson's barn.
Yeah. The newspaper boys used the traction also.
Well, the three Farley boys. Do you remember the Farley boys? You've heard of it.
Norm Farley?
Norm Farley?
Yes, I remember Norm.
Well,
Farley.
He was a paper boy when I first went on there. Uh-huh. He'd throw him out the back window. And when he quit, his next brother took it.
Yeah.
And then when he quit, the third boy took it, but the third boy was sick. You know, there was something wrong with him. He wasn't on very long. But the Farley boys was paper boy all the time I was on there.
Well, what do you mean there were paper boys in the train? They threw the...
Well, they'd get the papers here at Rose Station and stand in the back end of the car and throw them out the back window. Sometimes they'd go over in the field or something. But they were on all the time.
What kind of speed could you get on the traction line?
Well, automobiles in them days, if they went 40 miles an hour, they're doing pretty good. I can remember the first time I ever went 40 miles an hour in an automobile. And we had to be going down grade to beat an automobile. So we went about 40 miles an hour. Coming down from Glendale Curve, just this side a little ways, there's a government farm. Well, from there to the Main Street in Lambeth, it's all downhill. That's about the only place we could beat the automobiles. And the first day I was dispatching, I took the sheet at 3 o'clock, and we killed a woman at stop 11. That's just first stop west of that government farm. She came there with her sister by horse and buggy to catch the northbound car. But the southbound car, which was to meet it at Lambeth, came first. And she was standing down beside the horse, and the horse got scared like they all did them days. She backed up from front of the horse, backed right in front of the traction car, and she was killed. Of course, that tied things up for nearly 2 hours. Time to get the coroner and the doctor and all the rest of it.
Paul, we should just say where that traction line ran from London to Lambeth to Talbotville, and then up into St. Thomas.
Lyndhurst.
And Mr. Jewell, could you perhaps trace it from the time it gets up to where Lyndhurst now is to where it went through St. Thomas?
Well, it came down from Talbotville on the east side of the highway till it got pretty near to the Wabash Tracks. There was a house at the Wabash Tracks. There's two there now. But it come down to this house.
Yeah.
Then it went east through the Gilbert Farm, about a half mile, and then it circled around till it come to the Wabash Tracks, west of Wellington Road. Well, we stayed on the north side of the Wabash till after we crossed the Wellington Road. And as soon as we crossed the Wellington Road, we went down, made a sharp turn underneath the Wabash, and up on the other side, and followed Lyndhurst Street.
Okay, I just stop you there, because I have a picture here they may be able to see. That's the old, can you just hold that down like that? That's the old, that's the Wabash track, and that's the old culvert that's now filled in, and that's where the traction line came under the Wabash.
Yes.
That's up on the top of Lyndhurst. And then where to go from the top of Lyndhurst?
Well, it went down, followed Lyndhurst, I think it's Lyndhurst Avenue or Lyndhurst Street,
yeah.
That main street in Lyndhurst. We followed that down till we come to where that gentleman told you had a son that's a magician.
The Housley House.
Housley.
Yes.
When we got down to Housley's, he was back quite a ways from the street. We turned off, left the road, but right by his gate, there was a stop at his gate, and down the side hill, and come out down where you turn now to come down out of the, to catch the, get on the new highway.
I see.
Just maybe 100 feet east of that. That's where our trestle, we had a big trestle and a bridge. Then we made a sharp turn and come up the hill, approximately where the road comes up the hill today.
The present highway.
And when you're halfway up the hill today, if you watch on the south side, you'll see a little bit of the old traction road
embankment. You can see that.
And we come out at the top of the hill, just about where we used to. And we went on to the city line. Went down Talbot Street on the city line to Alma. The streetcars went up Alma, but we had a little line of our own from Alma to Inkerman. We went back on the city line at Inkerman, down to the Foundry Curve, and down under the New York Central to Wellington. And the streetcars went west on Wellington, but we went straight down on the west side of First Avenue until we come almost to Elm. And there was a racetrack over in there then. We had a racetrack siding. And we turned east on the north side of Elm, right where the little bank is out there today.
Okay.
We'd go right through the middle of that.
Yeah.
For about a couple of hundred yards, and then it turned south and went 3 miles almost direct south. There was a little jog at each road, but just a, it was 3 miles down to the 4th Concession. And we come out on the 4th Concession just east of Mrs. Hepburn's house today. If you go down there any time and stop just east of her house and look north, you'll see the fill where we come down the old gravel pit there now and around. And then we went west on the 4th Concession past her house on the north side of the road for nearly a half a mile. Then we went straight south about a half a mile. Then we angled off and came down over the hill into over Union Pond.
Yeah. And I think that we could remind people that if they're driving on present number 4 highway and they come to Union Pond, if they look to the left,
look to the east,
they'll see a culvert. Look to the east, they'll see a culvert
that's
and the embankment
old, that's
the traction line followed into Union.
That's quite a cut there. I know they had a farmer by the name of Sullivan plow all night, keep it from freezing so they could work days on it. It's clay, you know, and had to keep it plowed all the time.
When they're building the road or?
When they're grading it. It's quite a cut to come down the hill out of the pond over the fill.
Uh-huh.
They used all this clay they dug out to fill the fill in over the culvert.
Uh-huh.
And
they had him plowing it all night?
Plowed all night to keep it from freezing. Dan Sullivan.
That's when they were building that.
That's when they were digging the road.
Yeah.
And then they pulled into Union, of course. And then I told you approximately where they went south of Union, crossed over the Sparta Road.
We have one picture here, if you could hold that end of it. This is Hepburn's Hill, and that little thing there is the what's left of the grade. where you went down the hill onto the highway there. The Hepburn's farm, this is the
is
high
ground. Is this Hepburn's yard?
No. Hepburn's is not in the picture. They're over.
Oh.
But you went down the hill here.
Oh, you mean down the other Hepburn's, down where the
yes,
truckers.
Yes, that's the Hepburn.
Truckers, yeah, sure.
Trucking, yes.
Here's the highway over on the west
yes,
bank.
Yes,
and the traction went along the east bank.
Yes, yeah.
You can see where the old highway was down there now,
yes.
Over on the west bank.
Yeah. And then the one other thing, perhaps, this is the station in Port Stanley.
That's it, and it's still there, only it's fallen down.
Well, it's by the Clifton Hotel. It's behind the Clifton Hotel.
That is the post office, and this was our waiting room here.
Uh-huh.
And Matt Payne was the postmaster.
I see.
And our tracks quit right, that is the cars quit here, but there was a spur around behind that, way over to the bridge. And the main line also went down right to the lake, to Brown's Fish Caddy.
How much of a fish trade was there, Mr. Jewell?
Well, I don't know. There used to be 18 boats at one time, and I've seen the boats come in with so many fish. I've seen men digging them out of the net, and they'd throw them back, and the bottom of the boat is so full it'd slide off back in the water.
The traction counted heavily originally on it when it built the line.
We used to get, in the busy time, 2 and 3 carloads a day in the fall, and they sold them for about 4 cents a pound. They're down there now, and they want about $2 a pound.
Oh, $2.50.
Is it?
$2.50.
Well, I haven't bought any lately, but yes, I had a little picture home and showed you the locomotive, our locomotive, and 3 flat cars down in front of the last fish house, and they got them piled up about 4 boxes high, 100 pound a box, ice and all, and they were loading them on these 3 flat cars, so you know what they would take out of there that day, 3 flat car loads.
Well, now,
most of them went to the New York Central and switched over on the New York Central.
Could you tell us something about the Cross Lake passenger traffic, the Lady of Cleveland, was it? The
City of Cleveland.
City of Cleveland, the passenger boat.
Well, I don't know much about it. I was on it quite a few times for the moonlight excursion. It was only 25 cents out and back.
Yeah.
And, of course, all the young people had to go out and back in the moonlight excursion.
Yeah.
And we used to have quite a lot of fun coming back. Somebody would be up around the wheelhouse with the first mate or whoever run the searchlight. And of course, he had to find the harbor, pitch dark.
Yeah.
And he'd find the harbor all right, so the wheelsman could. Then he'd run it along the lake bank. You'd see lots of young couples along there run, get out of the picture.
But you used to meet the City of Cleveland to get the passengers.
Yeah, and take them to London.
What time?
5 o'clock in the morning.
So it would come over, and you'd meet it at 5 o'clock and take what passengers wanted to go to St. Thomas or London. And then that boat hung around all day and did a couple moonlight excursions.
Yes, every third night. And then it would leave. It lay there until midnight, go back to Cleveland, and do the same thing over there, I suppose. I don't know. I never went across on it. But it'd come in Monday, Wednesday, and Friday at 5 a.m. and left at midnight. And it generally brought a carload of people. Most of them for London. Yeah, I had that run for quite a while, conductor.
Mr. Jewell, what kind of traffic did the racetrack get from the track?
Well, I guess the racetrack was a pretty busy place for a year or two, but looks like everything else. It was right on the corner. Of course, it's all houses now. But we used to go down First Avenue within about 200 feet of Elm. We turned east, but our siding went on right along parallel with the fence for the racetrack. And that was racetrack just over the fence. There was no houses in there then.
Would you get passengers coming from London to go
to the racetrack? Well, we used to have a racetrack special, like they did down to Windsor for them big racetracks from Windsor, or from Detroit. We used to have a crew on a racetrack day. All they'd done was run from the west end of Talbot Street, down Talbot, and over First Avenue to the racetrack, and just keep running back and forth. Run extra. They didn't have to have an order, and that's how the people used to get out there. The streetcars didn't go out there, and nobody had automobiles, so it was quite a thing. And one year they had some airplanes out there, put on quite a demonstration.
The City of St. Thomas used to complain because it was operating the municipal railway, that the traction was acting like a municipal railway because they stopped so much on Talbot Street. And they weren't supposed to stop, were they?
You're supposed to stop at the top of the hill, the Iroquois Hotel, Grand Central, Rose Depot, and Ross Street, and not again until you go down to the end of, down to the Iron Foundry corner, First Avenue corner. But somebody wanted to get off, what are you going to do? You stop and let them off. That's the way we used to do it, anyhow.
The city of St. Thomas used to get very annoyed with the
Well, I had quite an argument with a minister from Temple one time. He called me everything but a white man because he wanted to get off at the Grand Central. I stopped at Iroquois, and I stopped at the Grand Central, and quite a bunch got off, and nobody looked as though they wanted to get off, so I gave the motorman two bells. He come tearing back there, and he was going to have me fired, and I don't know what all, but I wasn't worrying much. I knew what would happen, but we let them off anyway. If a farmer wanted to get off at a station, and he had a half mile to walk back, what was the sense of carting him down to that station and then let him walk back a half mile? He had to stop anyhow, and you might as well stop at his gate at the stop. Always stopped anywhere.
Another thing that I heard about the traction line was that there were so many passes that people had that they didn't get very much revenue.
Well, there could have been a lot, but I don't know anything about that. See, I always picked a run, make sure I had a job. But I didn't run it one quarter of the time. If there was a work train or a snowplow or a line car out or anything like that, I always took
Or the Irish picnic, something extra.
Well, I took the motorman's job. I like motorman better than I did conductor. Uh-huh. The public's the hardest thing on earth to handle.
Yes,
and I certainly
are.
Didn't like it.
Mr. Jewell, who was responsible for maintaining the line? I was under the impression that a lot of, when you went across a farmer's crossing and so often, that they would look after it. Is this true? And that they would quite often get something from the company for looking after it?
Well, of course, I don't know anything about that. I worked on the section too a little bit. And Bill Evans, he was roadmaster. He lived in Lambeth. I was on the work train an awful lot, but I never heard anything about, we just fixed the road up as we went, whether it was a farmer's lane or didn't matter what it was. I didn't ever hear anything about it like that. No. Well, it was the best job I ever had, as far as job went. Jolly bunch of fellows. Yeah, I remember one time we pulled into London, and it was always the conductor's job to go in to get the orders to go back, and this was the last car. And I pulled in, and the motorman, he's supposed to change in. Well, he'd been in the hotel down at Fort Stanley and got a bottle, and I didn't know it. Well, I did know it before I got to London, because he tell the way he run the car. So I got my orders and come out. I looked over, and there he was, still sitting on his stool. Well, I had to get him back at the other end of the car and change the controllers and bring his chair for him and change the trolley poles and one another. Come time to go, I went to the back of the car. I had a pretty fair carload. Last car on Saturday night, I gave him two bells and he didn't move. I gave him two more bells and he didn't move, so I went up and opened the door and run the curtain up. The curtain stops the glare in front. Yeah. There he was laying down in the corner. I knew I couldn't ever pick him up. One of the nicest men I ever worked with. He just had these sprees once in a while.
Right.
But anyhow, I went and shut the back doors and sat on, run the car and took the tickets as they got off. And I brought the car to St. Thomas and put it in the barn and left him down in the corner. I don't know when he got up or anything about it. Next day, he was back on the job. One of the nicest fellows
ever. Mr. Jewell, one of the problems the traction had, as I gather, was heating the cars in the wintertime.
Well, I
would... They did not have a very good heating system.
We just had a stove with hot water pipes running along below the window. We always had a good stove, good fire. Well, maybe not as good as they have today, but I never was bothered with any cold. They didn't heat maybe as good as they would today.
Well, the kids
was our biggest trouble, school kids. You know, some conductors could make them mine, and some of them couldn't do anything with them.
And it's like bus drivers today.
Well, the kids, we'd get a carload going out to Port Stanley at 4 o'clock, and you hardly, well, two and three times a week, you'd bring a car back with a seat tore off the floor or a couple of windows busted or something like that. And yet you get another conductor like Squeak Thompson or some of them fellas, they told them to give them the law before we started out, and that was it. And they didn't bother, but some some other fellow that wasn't so good at it, why, we pulled into a siding down there to get orders at Hepburn Siding. That's just north of Mrs. Hepburn. I wasn't on it. It wasn't me running. Another crew I was dispatching. The conductor went in the booth to get an order. One of the kids gave the motorman two bells, so the motorman away went. Got down and got a mile down the prisoner of the Union and found out he didn't have any conductors. So he started to back up, which is against the law, but of course he went on that road. There was no other traffic. And he come back quite a ways and he met the conductor running down the road, picked him up and went on down to Fort Stanley.
A lot of people don't realize, too, that in the early days of the traction you had trouble with Sunday traffic. And I know there were a number of court cases over the running of the traction on Sunday.
Well, there was well, that was before my time. When I was on there, Sunday was a big day. Big day, one of the biggest days of the week, outside of a picnic day.
Well, the traction originally in the early days was fined $200 for taking traffic down, and they needed this traffic very badly.
Well, when I went on in 15, of course, it'd been running quite a while. Sunday was a big day. We didn't start out as early in the morning, but had all kinds of passengers during the day, afternoon and evening.
Was the LMPS running passenger trains at that time also?
Well, they started on the 1st of July, 1915. Of course, when they started, they made a trip from one end to the other in about an hour. Our running time was an hour and a half. But we laid at each end of the road a half an hour, which made 4 hours for a round trip. But they made a round trip, I guess, in just a little over 2 hours.
Yes. They had brand new cars. But
they didn't go near as far as we did, or didn't have near as pleasant a drive, a ride. We followed the highway all the way, and they went down, come right down through the farms. If you wanted just to go for a ride, well, I would say the traction was the best, but if you was in a hurry, why, of course, take the LNPS.
Well, then, I suppose the LNPS with the faster time and more trains per day.
Oh, yes.
And the automobile.
Well, that's when they were coming in, yeah. 1915 and 18. Yes. Well,
another factor, too, was the coal contract the LNPS had, wasn't it? They ran a lot of coal.
They pulled all the LNPS right. pulled all the coal.
They made a lot of money on that.
From the Bessemer, the one that sank.
Listen, Paul, we have a picture here because Mr. Harry here went to work for the LNPS after the traction line for a year.
That's my job, and I'm the second man right there. Uh-huh. And that's the motorman. And that's the brakeman up here, Archie O'Neill, and the brakeman that goes in the front end. He's standing back of me there.
And this is the Bessemer 3 at Port Stanley at the coal dock.
That's 1918.
1918 picture.
And when I was in there. The man that took that, some photographer from the city, took two or three. I've seen a couple almost exactly the same. I know they were taking the same time because it's the same gang of people around there.
Now, were there any, what was the routine on that coal on unloading the Bessemer and loading her?
Well, of course, we'd go down there with the motor. We'd be in port, they'd call us.
Yeah.
When they heard the motor, the Bessemer's on her way across, they'd call a crew and we'd be down there waiting. And we always hung on to these empties because we couldn't get any closer to the boat than we are. There's the end of the line.
Oh,
the pantograph would hit, see, and we had to have a couple of dummies to reach the boat, reach the cars in the boat.
So just for the listeners, you had to have three cars in
front
of that.
Two or three,
so that you could get in to
catch
them.
Well, you pull the inside right. There's four rows of cars, 30 cars in all is a rule. Once in a while, if you had some short cars, you'd get 31. That's the most. But it was either 29 or 30. Well, they're in four rows. Well, so you wouldn't upset the boat, you had to pull the inside right row, then go and pull the outside left, then the outside right and the inside left.
I see.
And that's how you kept them tipping the boat over.
And you just repeat that order once more now?
Well, you pull the right side. See, there's four rows.
Yeah.
The outside rows were the longest, and there was two short ones in here. You pull the inside right, then you pull the outside left, then the outside right, and the inside left.
I see, yeah.
And that kept the boat from tipping over.
Yeah.
And there's 30 cars as a rule. And that made three train loads. We could take 10 cars up to what they call the steam shovel cut, south of the opposite Union there. That's a pretty bad cut. We had more than 10 cars, why we'd be in trouble. We'd be slipping and sliding and have to, you know, back
up. Where did you deliver that coal to?
Well, most of it went to the New York Central, and the rest went to London. The New York Central, it was billed. What I had to take the bills into the Tower 4, right over here or wherever it is. All the coal, all the bills for all the cars, and it was all billed to Taylor, Ontario. But Taylor, Ontario was just the first town on the other side of Rodney on the New York Central. That's where the coal pile was.
That was where the big New York Central coal pile was.
Yeah.
So,
and, it was a pretty kind of a ticklish job pulling. And the funny part of it was we had a train master there, and he used to time us all the time. If we were 5 minutes too long, he'd let you know it. Well, on the old traction road, it didn't matter when you come back. But that's the difference in the two roads.
Yeah. Well, maybe it's why the LNPS lasted a little bit longer.
Well,
too.
Yes, of course. They were more modern. Cars were bigger. They could run five cars together. We only had two cars that had four motors. They had a trailer apiece, but they were a nuisance.
Paul, did you have a couple pictures that showed the different setups of the LNPS and the traction line of their cars?
That's the LNPS. That's the traction.
We'll put this one first here. Could you just hold that for me, Harry? This is the traction line, isn't it?
No, this is the LNPS. With the transit
with the pantograph. Yeah, with the pantograph.
That's right.
Yeah.
And tremendous power compared to
the traction. Well, they had 1,500 volts, and we only had 550.
Tremendous difference.
Yeah.
And then, this one up here, Harry, please.
Can we show this one, then?
Yeah, show this one, please.
But those cars are not coupled together because they never could run four cars together.
No. This is the traction coming out of London.
It's
come across the Richmond Street Bridge.
And over the trestle.
Over the trestle.
And the Smallman Estate is right along the... We run along the high board fence next to the Smallman Estate, which is the Shoot Clinic now, I think, isn't it?
Yes.
On Grand Avenue? We cross Grand Avenue.
One thing to notice here is the difference in the... The pantograph here, and then the sort of trolley pole here, and sometimes this could be a problem with them coming off
and they come off lots of times.
Sometimes on streetcars in cities, kids be tricksters and they pull them off and so on. And I've got one picture here just to give you another. There is a City of St. Thomas streetcar, which is more like the traction car. And after all, the traction did run over. The traction was originally a DC
line, and they done away with the second wire, and and they welded all the rail, and that done that took it away from the second wire. Right. I only had one wire.
And this is the City of St. Thomas municipal car, and it has the trolley pole here, very much like the traction.
And one at the other end, it pull one down, put up. Well, isn't that the car that run down Talbot and down Ross to Hemlock for years?
Yes.
And that's as far as it went, from the west end of Talbot Street to Ross, down Ross to Hemlock, east on Hemlock, just past Elmina Hill, that was the end. And it just run back and forward.
Yeah. And then there were additions on it.
Yeah. Now, could you just, I think we have a few minutes. Could you tell me, what was the loop line in St. Thomas? This was a street railway, the loop
line. Well, I told you the other night, and I think I'll give you a mistake. I'm not sure whether we went through on Pleasant Street or King. There's a street down the west end town called King.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Well, now, we either went along the top of the hill going west and went under King or Pleasant.
I think it went on Pleasant Street, Mr.
I think so. That's what
Pleasant
I said.
Pleasant Street is the...
And I told you we come back on Walnut, but we didn't. We come back on Center. To William Street and south on William. And then we went around the belt line, but there was also a run from Morning Street School out to the park.
I see. Now, where did that run?
Well, down Elgin and out over Pam Street Bridge, down Wilson Avenue to Alum, east on Alum to the park gates, and right in up there on top of the knoll is the end of the line. That's just a short run, you know.
Did many workers of the traction work for the city? Like, if you could operate a traction car, could you not operate a city car? I remember talking to Art Pierce about this. And
you could, but I never heard of any.
He went over to the city, and he just said he got fed up trying to run the car and make change and all this, and he went back to the traction.
Well, he went to the LNPS.
After, yes.
Yeah. He was on the LNPS for a long while. But I never heard of anybody going from the traction to the city. I've heard of them going from the city to the traction. There used to be a farmer out here by the new water tower. Carter? He sold his farm. He's dead now. But when we was going down Tauba Street, if we'd pull away from the depot, we had to look west to see if there's anybody coming this side of Iroquois Switch. Well, whichever one got out on the main line first had the right of way. So one Saturday night, I left Rose Depot and went west. I got down to the old Star Theater, and there was about 50 people come out. And while I was loading them up, this fellow, Carter, come from the west, and he claimed he was out on the main line first. Well, we sat and looked at one another for about 10 minutes, and then he decided to back up, and I went. He knew he was in the wrong. I was there, all right, but I was loading passengers, and he came down while I was loading.
And that was the city street car.
That was right in front of the, right on top of the street.
Uh-huh. Listen, I think we're going to have to wind up a couple of things. In the 14th September 1918, you went to work for the Michigan Central.
Yeah.
And what did you do there? You worked there until the 14th of March, 58.
Yeah, 40 years, approximately.
And what did you do?
Well, I operated the crane. Uh-huh. I operated the 150-ton crane, mostly. Used to pick up anything up to 150-ton.
Yeah.
And there was one 20-ton crane and one 10-ton crane over the machine shop. Like anything else, it was quite a thing when you first start. But after you get used to it, you might as well pick up 150-ton as 150-pound.
Yeah.
It's all the same thing.
I guess
only
so.
Maybe you have to watch what you're doing a little more.
Yeah.
Had 15 men underneath it when it's going up and down sometimes.
Yeah.
Pick up an engine and set it down on the wheels, and there was a man at every journal. There'd be about 16 men under there. But just like anything else, when you get used to it. I can remember the first engine I ever picked up. I held my hand out. I wasn't sweating like this, but I held my hand up, and the water run off my fingers. Just nerves.
Yes. Well, Harry, I'm starting to call you Harry.
Well, that's what I want.
And Paul, we have to wind up the program. I'd like to thank people for watching. And if you've enjoyed any of these programs, would you mind dropping a card to the station? They'd like to get some feedback, whether you're watching them or not. And I'll be back again on the second Wednesday in September with Brian Sim on the military history of the Elgins. And Paul and Mr. Jewell,
Harry,
I'd like to thank you very, very much for giving us your time.
It.
And I'm sure it's been a very informative evening for me anyway.
I've always got time to talk about the old traction.
And thank you very much, and good evening.